Welcome back, geology fans. When Harry Hess first proposed seafloor spreading in 1960, many geologists were not willing to buy it without more extraordinary evidence. We discussed in the last episode many of the features Hess saw making him think seafloor spreading was true, and he even had some extra evidence. Today we discuss that extra evidence and the subsequent evidence that allowed the geologic community to embrace seafloor spreading and plate tectonics before the decade was out. Harry Hess could point out that there were shallow earthquakes at the ridges, in line with seafloor extending, cracking, and pulling apart, while over at the trenches, Kiyu Wadati and Hugo Benioff independently discovered an interesting pattern in 1949. Now known as Wadati-Benioff zones, these are areas with shallow earthquakes near a trenched surface, but from the trench the earthquakes got deeper in a line slanting away from vertical down to the mantle where things start to flow more than pop. If the trench was near a continent, the Wadati-Benioff zone tilted toward the continent, which often had a line of volcanoes up there at its edge, too. If the trench was at sea, the zone leaned toward an arc of volcanic islands. This evidence led one to imagine that we are seeing earthquakes caused by subduction. Shallow near the trench, deeper at an angle below. We can imagine subduction taking down more felsic sediments with water, which can cause melting more easily, producing the magma needed for volcanic action on the other overriding plate side. Intriguing to think about, but is this all you have, Dr. Hess? No, Hess would reply. When he was at sea during the war, he not only had a depth sounder, but towed a magnetometer behind his ship. Magnetometers measure magnetic fields and must be towed behind your own ship because every ship makes its own field. These were used to try to detect enemy subs, but Hess had noticed that the ambient Earth's field varied substantially as he dragged this thing over the ocean floor. He reasoned that the strong fields occurred where the seafloor had been made capturing the same magnetic field direction as today, and the weaker field areas had seafloor with opposite magnetization, reducing the present field. Recall from episode 6 on magnetic declination that the Earth's magnetic field can flip from normal, as it is today, to reversed, and has done so many times through geologic history. Hess reasoned that if whole areas of seafloor had either normal or reverse magnetization, they must be made at different times. Still intriguing, but not enough yet to win the crowd. There were also the apparent wanderings of magnetic poles stored in continental rocks. The rocks pointed to different poles from each other through time, which made no sense unless the continents had moved in the past independently. Taken back far enough, the continents finally have mutual polar wandering of their apparent polar direction when you join all the continents together as Pangaea and they move as one. But it took one more piece of magnetic evidence to really tip the geologic community's balance. It was in 1963 that Fred Vine and Drummond Matthews reported their results from dragging much-improved magnetometers over the seafloor around a ridge with a more planned cruising pattern than Hess could ever have dreamed of during the war. Not that the job was without its troubles, as the two reported having to replace a few magnetometers as sharks had a habit of biting the things or breaking the cables. For me on land, it's deer, raccoons, snakes, stuff like that which can destroy your data collection plans, but, life is always one of the greatest unknown variables in real-world field data collection. But this work was eventually completed. What Vine and Matthews reported was that magnetic patterns on one side of a ridge come in linear or striped patterns of normal, then reversed, back and forth, and do so parallel to the ridges. Combine that with the general observation that basaltic ocean floor nearer the ridges is younger and gets older the farther from the ridges, and it sure looked like new basalt ocean crust was forming at the ocean ridges, pushing itself apart in both directions, capturing the Earth's magnetic field as it flipped back and forth. By 1966, Pittman and Heisler showed the stripes were real and symmetrical on either side of the ridges. If that weren't enough, the previous year, in 65, John Tuzo Wilson had pointed out something interesting about transform faults. J. Tuzo Wilson had already conclusively shown in 63 that ocean islands formed at ridges get older the farther they are from the ridge, but now he focused on the cuts in the earth that seem to connect offset segments of this ridge. A fault is a break in rocks with movement across the break. With no movement, we just call it a joint. Now, classic thought on faults was that if you saw two features displaced from each other, you would infer motion on the fault to move them away from where they were connected to where they are now. Transform faults come in many flavors, but they are cuts in the Earth's crust with mostly horizontal motion, and with the help of people like Murray Tharp, it was known by 1965 that mid-ocean ridges were cut into slices, joined by these transform faults. You can think of the segmenting of the ridge as trying to take a straight line and wrap it around a sphere, and nature is messy. J. Tuzo Wilson pointed out that if seafloor spreading were not true, we'd expect this ridge segment to have been joined and then broken apart, and thus the movement on the transform fault would be what you would expect as so. But if seafloor spreading were true, the movement on the transform fault would be the exact opposite of what you'd expect from just displacement. Wilson looked at seismic data from earthquakes that take place when these transform faults slip. By the nature of the earthquake waves, he could tell which way they were moving, and was able to publish his results in 1965 that the transform faults moved in a way that said seafloor spreading is real. By the time I was born in 1968, the geologic community had embraced seafloor spreading and extended it back to the ideas of plate tectonics. What moved were lithospheric plates of crust and rigid upper mantle that could have both continental and ocean on the same plate. At places, these plates pulled apart. At others, they came together. And at others, they just sheared past each other, scraping on their sides. All it took for most geologists was to look around their world again with new eyes, and no longer was it a mystery. Why do we get the earthquakes of the kinds we do where we do? Everywhere there are plate boundaries, we have more earthquakes, as the plates shift against each other. And their depth, power, and pattern are controlled by which kind of plate boundary you were at. Similarly, the distribution of volcanoes made sense, again, mainly coinciding with plate boundaries, and the type of volcanoes and eruptive style was explained by the type of plate boundary again. Why were there volcanic island arcs? Because a plate with ocean crust on its leading edge was converging with another ocean crust plate boundary. The plate that subducted dragged water-rich sediment down with basaltic crust, and as material began to melt, it floated back up to the surface to make these andesitic volcanic islands. They run in an arc because that's the shape you get when you depress a trench into a spherical earth, a bit like making a dent into a ping-pong ball, and the edge of the dent is an arc. Mountain ranges could be seen as one plate with continental crust running into another plate. Sometimes ocean crust could carry island arcs and slam them against the side of the continent, growing it out and triggering modest mountain growth. Or other times, a whole other continent would come in for a collision, and something more grand like the Himalayan mountains would rise up. With plate tectonics, we got answers to why we had ocean basins and continents at all. Explanations for rift valleys, distribution of modern organisms and fossils, paleoclimate records, how the Earth could recycle its surface in both landforms and nutrients. Plate tectonics, driven by the mechanism of seafloor spreading, explain all these previous mysteries. Well, almost all. There are still oddballs out there. The Hawaiian Islands are in the middle of a plate. That's a special case. Another one is in my own backyard, the Rocky Mountains. These mountains, they didn't form on the edge of a continent with an island arc or collision of a continent. These mountains formed around 70 million years ago in the center of the continent. I will save this mystery for later as we specifically discuss plate boundaries, but let me end the evidence for seafloor spreading and plate tectonics by saying we can actually measure the plates moving relative to each other now. We can't measure one plate movement simply by relative to another plate because all the plates are in motion on the Earth's surface. We need a still point of reference to measure by. And today, this has been definitely accomplished with geostationary satellites and GPS technology. Just as GPS in your car can use your change in position over time to calculate velocity, the same can be done with whole continents, islands, mountains, tectonic plates. We can measure the speed and direction of each plate over the last few decades, and they move on the order of centimeters per year, which is often compared to be roughly equivalent to the rate of fingernail growth. Going back even farther, there are plumes of material that come up through the mantle and inject large amounts of more basaltic magma through the crust. These mantle plumes, or hot spots, don't have to be on a plate boundary, and that is actually why Hawaii is where it is. And they are thought to be relatively still points going back into the deep geologic past. And they, along with magnetic poles indicated in the rocks, show how the continents have been moving as the life upon them has been evolving. And these records, both of plate tectonics and evolution, blend smoothly and consistently into the world we see today. The evidence for plate tectonics is overwhelming. But when I say the mechanism is seafloor spreading, you should be a bit dissatisfied, for what are the possible fundamental mechanisms that drive seafloor spreading? Now that will be the subject of our next episode, here on Earth Explorations.